Very good morning, everyone. Today's topic of discussion is about nematodes. As we know that helminths divided into cystodes, trematodes and nematodes. In last few classes we are discussing about cystodes. Today we'll study about the details about the nematodes. So today outline will be about the three. One is general introduction, general characteristic of nematodes. There are 12 characteristics that we'll discuss one by one. And we are going to discuss about the one nematodes, that is Ascaris lumbricoides. Common name is roundworm. And its homeopathic approach. So we'll study about the general characteristic. As I told you, there are 12 characteristics are present in the nematodes. So number one is shape. The shape of all nematodes are round or elongated or cylindrical in shape, which is non-segmented and bilaterally symmetrical. So you can see these pictures. Okay, it is all the nematodes have round in shape, and it is a non-segmented, where cystodes are segmented. Here it is a non-segmented and bilaterally symmetrical. Both sides is the equal. So that's about the first shape of the nematodes. Next one, the size of the nematodes. Size of the nematodes starting from 5 mm to 1 meter. The 5 mm is the smallest nematode, that is Trichinella spiralis, and the longest nematodes is the Dragonglossis, that is a 1 meter. And sex, it is dioecious, and that means female and male parasites are different. Males are larger than the females are larger than the male, and posterior end of the male worm is curved ventrally. You can see the picture. This is the male worm and this is the female worm, and posterior end of this is the anterior end and this is the posterior end, and the posterior end of the worms are curved ventrally, where there is in the female it is straight. So that is the one. And the male worms are shorter than the female worms. And third one, it is the body cavity, body wall. The body wall made up of the four layers. One is epicuticle, from the outer layer, epicuticle, exocuticle, mesocuticle and endocuticle. So this four layer, all the parasites made up of this four layer. Okay. You can see in the histology slides, you can see the upper layer is known as the epicuticle, and endocuticle is the longitudinal muscle fibers, is the inner layer, innermost layer, it is the outermost layer. And the very important one to discuss is the molting. What is molting? Molting is shedding of the cuticle layer. So especially it is happening in the stage of larval stage. The larval stage, mostly it is L1 to L4 stage. All the nematodes have L1 to L4 stage. L1, L2, L3, L4. Okay. Shedding of epicuticle, that is known as the L1. Shedding of the exocuticle, that is known as the L2. Shedding of the mesocuticle, L3. Shedding of the endocuticle, it is known as the L4. Then it goes to the adult worm. So that we'll discuss in the today Ascaris lumbricoides we'll discuss. Okay. Then body cavity, the space between body wall, the space between body wall and the GAP are filled with the fluid. That fluid is responsible for many clinical features we will study later. And GAP are well developed. The GAP made up of simple columnar epithelium. And nervous systems are rudimentary. It is not well developed. However, it have the some of the nerve trunk will be available. Circular nerve trunk, it is surrounded the esophagus. And there are six longitudinal nerve ring will be present. One dorsal, that is that helping for the motor activity of the parasite, and four lateral, that helps for the sensory activity of the parasite, and one ventral having the both motor and sensory activities. So circular nerve trunk, one, and six longitudinal nerve trunk. And there is some of the sensory papillae will be present into the anterior end and posterior end, mainly into the male parasite. And movement, the parasite movement with the help of endocuticle. We have studied already, the endocuticle is the innermost layer. So that is made up of longitudinal muscle fiber, that helping for the movement of the parasite. And then male reproductive system, it is a well developed, and the ejaculatory duct and rectum open in the common passage in the posterior end. As we have studied into the human being, ejaculatory tract and urinary duct opens into together in the anterior aspect. So same in the parasite also, ejaculatory duct and the rectum opens in the common passage into the posterior end. And the female reproductive system is well developed, genital pore open in either middle of the body or near the mouth. So male, it is the open into the ejaculate, open into the common passage where there is a female cell in the separate. We'll discuss. And excretory, the last characteristics, excretory system, it is rudimentary, not well developed. Okay. So if you can see the histology, so this is the male worm, this is the female worm, and male worm, it is made up of, this is the layer, cuticle layer. And the male worm have testes, and this is the intestine, this is the intestine, and this is the ovary, and this is the uterus with the small eggs are there, and this is the posterior nerve trunk. Okay. So now we'll study about the common, that's all about the characteristic of the nematodes. We will study about the common intestinal nematodes. Okay. There are, for our better understanding, we divide it into two, small intestinal nematodes and large intestinal nematodes. So large intestinal nematodes are two. We are discussing two. Ascaris lumbricoides, the common name is roundworm, and Ancharistomum duodenale, the common name is hookworm. In the large intestine, Trichuris trichura, the common name is whipworm, and Endrobius verbicularis, this is the smallest nematodes. Endrobius, one of the smallest nematodes. Endrobius verbicularis is the threadworm, pinworm, silkworm, so many names are. Okay. So today we are discussing about the Ascaris lumbricoides, that is about the roundworm. Okay. So if you open this kingdom, all the parasites comes under the Animalia, and subkingdom it is a metazoa. As we told, all the worms comes under the metazoa. The protozoa parasite divided into two, protozoa and metazoa. So this metazoa known as the helminthes or worms. So all the worms comes under the metazoa. And phylum, it is a nematodes. I told you metazoa divided into the cystodes, trematodes and nematodes, so it comes under the nematoda. And class, there is only one class which is present, Chromodoria. And order is Ascaridae order, and the family same, and genus is Ascaris family, and species, there are two species, Ascaris lumbricoides and Ascaris sum. And most commonly this is the most infected to the human, Ascaris lumbricoides. Okay. So we are going to discuss about these headings, about the ascariasis. Introduction of this ascariasis, habitat, morphology, life cycle, pathogenesis, clinical features and diagnosis. Okay. Introductions. It is the largest intestinal nematodes of the human intestinal nematodes. The size is 20 to 35 cm into 3 to 6, 20 to 35 cm in length, 3 to 6 mm in the width. They are the most common in children than the adult. So most of the children is getting affected. And more than 1 billion people are infected in this world currently. And habitat. As we know, all the worm, the human is the definitive host, and it lives in the small intestine and mainly into the upper jejunum, is 85%, and cecum will be into the 15%. And morphology, as we are aware that all the worms having the three morphological features, ova, larva and adult worm. The larva have L1 to L4 larva, and ova in of round worm have two types, fertilized ova and unfertilized ova. And adult worm have two, male worm and female worm. So we'll discuss one by one. Let me go for the ova or egg. So this is about the, as I told you, there are two types of the ova. One is fertilized ova and unfertilized ova. So unfertilized ova is elongated shape, you can see the shape, and where there is a fertilized ova, you can see the shape, there is a rounded shape. This is a rounded shape, this is a elongated shape, and size also, the unfertilized ova is more. Here it is 80 to 90 micron, and here this is 40 to 70 micron. So this is the one. So as we discussed, shape is round, as we have seen in the picture, the unfertilized is elongated, size is, length is 40 to 70 micron, and width is 30 to 50 micron. And where there is unfertilized, length is 80 to 90 and width is 40 to 60. And color is bile stain. You can see there is a color is bile stain. It is a yellow color. And very important differentiating feature is the eggshell. Thick surrounded by mammillated or albuminous coat layer. And where there is a unfertilized ova, thin surrounded by mammillated albuminous layer. Okay. So you can see it here. This is the round. This is the one, thick color, thick black. This is the one, is a thick albuminous layer. Okay. Where there is, here it is, you can see, here it is the thin albuminous layer. Okay, that is the one difference. Next difference, this is the ovum. This is a single ovum will be present in the fertilized ova, and where there is a unfertilized ova, there is a multiple segmented ovum will be present. You can see one segmented ovum. It looks like a soap bubble appearance. And the next characteristics, in between this ovum and mammillated layer, there is a gap. This gap is known as the crescentric space. This gap will not be present into the unfertilized ovum. Okay, that is the difference. So crescentric space, as I told you, it is present into the only fertilized ova, and unfertilized ova it is absent. And ovum unsegmented with the crescentric space. Unfertilized is a segmented atrophied ovum, soap-like bubble appearance. You can see here it is a soap bubble appearance. There are many segmented ovum. Here it is a single ovum. That is the difference. And saturated salt solution, it is floats because weight is less. The saturated salt solutions examination done based on the weight of the ova. So here weight is less, so it floats. And unfertilized ova does not float. That means it sinks inside the saturated salt solution. So that's the difference between fertilized and unfertilized. Okay, so this fertilized, unfertilized, for our better understanding, we are divided into the two subtype. One is carticated fertilized ova, and next one is decarticated fertilized ova. What is a carticated? What is decarticated? Carticated means it is with the albuminous coat. Decarticated means without albuminous coat. Let me talk some examples. Okay, this is the fertilized ova of carticated. So how I am telling carticated? Because it is having the thick mammillated layer and having the single ovum, and there is between the ovum and the layer there is a gap, that is a crescentric space it is there. So this is known as the carticated. Okay, this also it is a 40x in the magnification. This is a single ovum and this is the mammillated layer. Between this ovum and mammillated layer there is a space, it is known as a crescentric space. Okay. And this is known as a decarticated fertilized ovum. So you can see this is the single ovum, okay, but here it is, mammillated layer is absent. Okay, if this this is known as a decarticated layer, single ovum without albuminous coat, that is known as a decarticated egg. Okay, this is the unfertilized egg. You can see the elongated shape and so many segmented ovum will be present inside the single ovum. And this is the, you can see the mammillated layer very thick, and inside there is a multiple ovum. Here also it is unfertilized egg with the multiple segmented ovum will be present. You can see the soap bubble appearance also. Okay, so that's about the, again, unfertilized ovum. You can see very properly, you can make it out the soap bubble appearance of the unfertilized ovum. So that's about the ova. Okay, we'll go for the larva. So larva, as I told you, it is totally have the four larval stage called L1, L2, L3, L4 through the, how it is they are making differentiation through the molting. Okay. Larva, there is a L1 larva and L2 larva we are calling as a reabdiform larva, and L3, L4 larva we are calling as a filariform larva. So length of the larva is a very short. In case of reabdiform larva, it is a short. And length of the filariform larva it is a long, and location it is present into the soil and intestine, and L3, L4 it is present into the lungs and the intestine. And esophagus and reproductive system, it is a prominent in case of reabdiform larva, where there is rudimentary in case of L3, L4 larva. Okay, let me explain with the diagram. Okay, so usually what happens, the ova, okay, it goes to the first stage, second stage, third stage, fourth stage, and it will become adult form. This is the normal life cycle of the parasite, nematodes. Okay, so where it is developing? In the case of ascariasis, ova to first stage of larva is happening into the soil. Even the second stage larva also is happening into the soil. Second stage to third stage, it is happening into the lungs. And third to fourth stage also it's happening into the lung, and fourth to adult stage it's happening into the intestine. Very easy to remember, first two stage in the soil, second two stage in the lungs, and maturation is taking place in the intestine and the adult form, both will be matting together and leads to the formation of the ova. This is the simple larva. Okay, so now we'll study one by one. So ova in the soil is happening into the first stage larva. There is some predisposing factors required. There should be pH should be less than 8, and there is a temperature of the soil should be 22 to 30 degrees Celsius, and the soil characteristic is a warm and clay soil should be required for maturation of the ova into the first stage of larva. So once the ova mature into the first stage of larva, which ova? That is a fertilized ova, not unfertilized ova. Which fertilized ova? Carticated fertilized ova will become first stage larva. Inside the ova, there will become first stage of larva. Then there will be first molting takes place. So as I told you, first molting takes place means shedding of this epicuticle. Okay. Once the shedding of the epicuticle, the first stage larva converted into the second stage larva. Then the second stage, the second molt taking place, the shedding of the extracuticle. Then second stage larva will become third stage larva. Third stage larva will become fourth stage larva by third molting, by shedding of this mesocuticle. And the fourth stage larva become adult worm by help of fourth molt. So that is the shedding of the endocuticle. This is the innermost layer. So shedding of this layer that leads to the fourth stage of larva will become adult worm. Then adult worm, male and female adult worm, copulation takes place, then formation of this ova, again this cycle will be continuing. So things to remember, here it is, two things is happening in the soil, next to two things is happening into the lungs and maturation into the intestine, and the fourth molting is taking place. So here it is within second day, this is within fifth day, and third molting within 10th day, and fourth molting within 29th day. So this is about the molting. Okay. There is one word, it is a very important word, is the embryonated egg. Where is embryonated egg? We have studied the ova, we have studied the larva, and we have studied about the adult worm. We have not mentioned about the embryonated egg. So what is embryonated egg? Okay, it's very important. The fertilized ova containing second stage of larva, it is known as the embryonated egg. So why we are studying here? Because this is the infective form of the human. So remember, embryonated egg means the fertilized ova containing second stage of larva. See, this is the ova and this is the larva, second stage of larva. Okay. So now we'll go for the adult worm. Adult worm, the shape of the adult worm is both are round with the tapering ends, and length is, as we studied into the common characteristic of nematodes, female worms are larger than the male worms. You can see here the female worms are larger than the male worms, and here it is 15 to 30 in case of males, 20 to 35 in case of females. Okay. And appearance, both are brownish, and anterior posterior ends are curved. Okay. Anterior end. It have two type of end, anterior end and posterior end. So this is the anterior end, this portion is anterior end, this portion is the posterior end. So anterior and posterior end, thinner, having three tooth lips. This is very important. Having three lips, one dorsal and two ventral. So here it is. There are the three lips. The roundworm mouth containing three lips. There is a two ventral and one dorsal. This is three lips. Okay. And posterior end, as we studied, this is the anterior end and this is the posterior end. So anterior end we have studied, it is present in mouth, is present into the anterior end. Okay. And posterior end, it is a thicker, blunt and coiled. Where there is in the female, it is same, thick and blunt and straight, as we discussed. It is coiled and this is the straight. And body cavity is filled with the fluid known as ascaris or ascarin, which GIT and genital organ flow. So this ascaris is responsible for many clinical features, we'll discuss later. And genital opening, next difference is genital opening. The genital opening happening in the posterior end in the two speakers. Okay. And in one speakers containing one testis. Okay. Junction, where there is in case of female, the genital opening taking place at the junction of anterior and middle one third of the ventricular surface. That is known as the vulvar waist. Okay. You can see it, the posterior portion of the male worm, we are known as the cloaca. Okay. So where there is a genital system is opening here, you can here there is a red color, the white marking. So this is genital opening taking place into the posterior aspect, into the cloaca. The posterior portion is known as the cloaca. Okay. Where there is a genital opening in case of female, genital opening taking place in the anterior and middle one third. So this portion is known as the vulvar breast. So this is the next difference. And sensory papillae It is present into it is present in case of males. It is absent in case of females. So here I am mentioning this is the orange color present into the anterior aspect also and posterior aspect also. Where there is in the females, it is absent. And anus, next difference, anus open into the colaco posterior end on dorsal surface, and female it is present like a slit posterior end on the ventral surface. And lifespan is 1 year in case of males and 1 to 2 years in case of females. You can see the anus here, it is present into the posterior end, okay, is near to the colaca. So the colaca is the area is a posterior aspect of the male bone. And where there is in the female, it is looks like a slit and it is present into the anterior aspect of the or ventral aspect of the posterior end. Okay, so this is about the pictures. This is the worm, adult worm, and you can see this is the male adult worm. Why? Because the posterior end is curved. That's about the morphology. Next we'll go for the life cycle. So life cycle is very simple. Infective form is embryonated egg. I told you what is embryonated egg. Fertilized ova with second stage of larva, it is known as the embryonated egg. Source of infection is ingestion of the contaminated food and drinks. Definitely host is human, and this life cycle is happening into the 2 months, 4 to 8 weeks. And this is a simple overview of the life cycle. Embryonated egg is an infective form that will come to the intestine. Then from the intestine, it migrate to the lungs. In the lungs, from the lungs, again reinfect to the intestine. And from the intestine, again, it goes to the embryo, formation of the embryonated egg. Then life cycle will be continued. Okay. So for better understanding, I divided into the 4 sub-stages. One is stage of infection. Stage of infection means embryonated egg to intestine. From the intestine to the lungs, migrating. So that I am mentioning in the stage of migration. From the lungs to, again it goes to the intestine. So I am mentioning in the stage of reinfection. From the intestine, it goes to the again formation of the egg. So we are making the stage of maturations. Okay, so 4 stages. So we will study first stage of infection. Embryonated egg, via stomach, it reaches to the small intestine. You may ask questions, the stomach containing HCl, why the HCl is not destructing this ova? The answer is very simple. HCl is an acidic character, and the same thing, this ova, fertilized ova or embryonated egg also having acidic character. So and the HCl unable to destruct the ova. So what happens, it comes to the small intestine, where the small intestine, the presence of alkaline media, there is a pepsin and bile. So that helps to destruction of the mammillated layer. So as we know, the mammillated layer inside the ova, there is a presence of second stage of larva. So the destruction of the mammillated layer, so this larva will come out that attached to the microvilli. So till this stage, it is known as the stage of infection. Then afterwards, the larva migrate from the intestine to the liver, okay, via portal circulation. Then it reaches to the right heart via inferior vena cava. Then from the right heart reaches to the lung with the help of pulmonary circulations. In the lung, it mature into the second and third molt taking place on 5th and 10th day. We have seen it. Okay. From the lungs, it taking to the, why it is taken in the 4th molt? Because the nutrition, everything will be getting from the lungs. So the 2 molting taking place, then reaches to the lung alveoli. So when it reaches to the lung alveoli, it is ascends up to the bronchial tree. That means alveoli to the bronchioles, from the bronchus, then trachea, then larynx, then reaches to the pharynx. So this, till this stage we are calling as a stage of migration. Okay, once the stage of reinfection, it reaches to the pharynx. Okay, now with the cough reflex or swallowing effect, this is the more common symptom the children's present in our clinic. So pharynx, the cough reflex, the swallowing effect that leads to the larva re-entry to the stomach. So there in the stomach again, 4th molding taking place on 25th to 29th day. So that reaches to the small intestine. So this stage is known as the stage of reinfection. Once it reaches to the small intestine, it develops into the male worm and female worm. So both will be copulation taking place, and female worm liberates the egg in the soil. So in the soil, again, the repetition of the life cycle is appearing. So this is a simple 4 stage. Stage of infection, stage of migration, stage of reinfection, and stage of maturation. So that's about the simple life cycle. The total duration of the life cycle is 4 to 8 weeks. Now we'll go for the pathogenesis. So pathogenesis under the three heading. One is ova and larva. Why we are calling as a migrating larva? Because it is migrated from the intestine to lung, lungs to intestine, everything. So we are calling it, the simple name is migrating larva, and symptom due to our pathogenesis due to the adult worm. This ova producing only infective form, especially fertilized ova. Unfertilized ova will not produce any symptom. I will not infect the human. So ova, it is responsible for infective form. And the migrating larva is producing the Loeffler's syndrome. And adult form producing a three type, intestinal and extra intestinal lesions, allergic lesion, and third one, it is the malnutritions. We'll study one by one. Okay, migrating larva, it's producing the Loeffler syndrome. What is Loeffler syndrome? Signs and symptoms by migrating the larva in the lungs leads to hypersensitive reaction, usually type 1 hypersensitive reaction, which shows non-productive cough. The patient with present with the complaints of non-productive cough, low-grade fever, breathlessness, chest pain with peripheral eosinophilia on the examination. And the chest x-ray shows a characteristic picture of transient patchy infiltration. So this Loeffler syndrome present mainly because of type 1 hypersensitivity reaction with this much symptom with the peripheral eosinophilia with the characteristic of x-ray findings. So this is the x-ray finding. You can see the bilateral peripheral infiltration into the upper part of the lungs. So is a infiltration. So that shows the Loeffler syndrome. Now we'll go for the adult worm. So adult worm, intestinal lesion producing mechanical lesions like intestinal obstruction, intestinal perforation and intestinal obstruction, and extra intestinal lesions, it producing same appendicitis, hepatic abscess and expelling out, and leads to some of the suffocative symptom. Okay, so very important symptom is the allergic symptom. As I told you, this allergy is responsible from the ascaris. There is a fluid present into the roundworm. So that responsible for this clinical features. Urticaria, facial edema, conjunctivitis, rashes and irritation of the upper respiratory tract. Most of our, in our OPD, most of the children come with this complaint. You may think of roundworm. And next, very important, very common in our routine practice, malnutrition. So malnutrition with stunted growth in children. Most of the children will come with the thing. And very important one, it's very good for our treatment. Impairment of the cognitive, affective and psychomotor activity leads to disturbance of the performance in the education, learning and motor skills. So you know what is cognitive? Thinking, everything is the cognitive, and affective, the mood affections, everything comes under the affective, psychomotor skills. Everything will be deranged, in that leads to disturbance of the education, learning and motor skills. And most commonly affected children, that also age group is 5 to 10 years. Most of the symptom, the patients will present or children will be present in this department. So we can select the remedy based on this one. Okay, let me talk later. Then clinical features. Some of the clinical features I am narrating: abdominal pain, nausea and vomiting, diarrhea with passing of worms in the stool, cough with bloody sputum, and breathlessness, low grade fever, small bowel obstruction, and sleeplessness. This is some of the clinical features where the children will present. And diagnosis, very important one. There are four stages. One is stool examination. Commonly we are routinely following the stool examination. Next one is imaging. Third one is detection of the larva. And fourth one is serology. We'll talk about the stool examination. Under the stool examination, we'll go for the two examination. One is the simple saline preparation and another one is the brine flotation method. So brine flotation method, as we aware that the method is based on the weight of the parasite, which lighter than the solution will float or sink into the bottom if it is weight is more. Okay, very simple understanding. Fertilized ova, it is floats, and where this unfertilized ova, it is sinks. That means non-fertilized ova. So this way you can differentiate the two ova comparison. And the simple saline preparation, this method to help to identify the ova and adult parasite from the clinical sample. Okay, so unfertilized ova, we can see this is elongated shape. Fertilized ova, it is a rounded shape. And decorticated ova, rounded with the mammillated layer. Okay, so this is the unfertilized ova. You can see the mammillated layer, thin mammillated layer. You can see the soap bubble appearance. And here it is a fertilized ova. There is a single ovum. Between single ovum, there is a space and there is a mammillated layer. Okay, and decorticated ova means there is a single ovum without albuminous core. There is a colorless albuminous core. So this is decorticated. Decorticated egg. Okay, next is imaging. Imaging in the three way you can able to detect: X-ray, barium beam and ultrasonography. Commonly we are using is the barium beam. So you can see this is the barium beam X-ray. You can see inside the stomach, small intestine, there is a bulging of presence of small thing, and you can notice down here also there is a many worms are present. Okay, and detection of the larva by the two method: sputum examination and another one is a gastric and duodenal aspiration. The sputum examination is again common. Why? The sputum examination give additional information about one Charcot Leyden crystal. What is Charcot Leyden crystal? This Charcot Leyden crystal will present, normally will present into the cytoplasm of the eosinophil and basophil. When there is a infections, when there is infection of the adult form, activation of the eosinophil that leads to destruction of the eosinophil due to parasitic infection, which may see in the stool or sample. So this normally will present into the cytoplasm of the eosinophil. When the destruction of the eosinophil will come out, will see into the blood. So that indicates that if it is indicated in the stool and indicated in the sputum, we can go for the diagnosis. And this is the Charcot Leyden crystal which present into the sputum. Fourth one is the last one of the diagnosis, the serodiagnosis. As we aware that it is the type of agglutination test where soluble antigen coated into the Ascaris antigens on the RBC. So what is the end result? Measure the antibody against the antigens coated RBC. Let me talk on small example. This is the in the test tube. Okay, we are adding antigen coated RBC. Here antigen it is the Ascaris antigen, roundworm antigen. So this is the RBC and this is the antigens. So we are adding the patient serum. Okay, we aware that serum means plasma minus clotting factor or protein. So if you are adding, so if the patient serum containing antibody, so what happened? Antigen antibody reaction taking place that leads to destruction of the RBC, and plus we can detect the antibody measurements in the titer. So that indicates the positiveness of the patients. If it is destruction of the RBC and you can able to detect the antibody, that means positive of the serodiagnosis or IgA. Then the last one, it is a molecular test. Single copy of the few copy of the DNA extract from the clinical sample that identify the DNA of the Ascaris. And other investigation, complete blood count, you can see the eosinophilia is more than 6% and absolute eosinophilic count is increased. Liver function test, all the parameter, 6 parameter will be increased. Pulmonary function test also to detect the larval stage, that also will be increased. All the lung volume and capacity will be increased or decreased depend upon the pathogenesis of the bacteria. And next we'll go for the homeopathic management. So homeopathic management, as we know that disease diagnosis and person diagnosis, both is required for the remedy diagnosis. So if anyone, if you going for only with the disease diagnosis, is known as a pathological prescription. So if pathological prescription is good for emergency purpose and it give the recovery, not the cure. But if you go with disease diagnosis with the person diagnosis, then you can get the cure. So person diagnosis, you can go with this level, constitution level, diathesis level and adaptive level. Okay, let me talk with a few remedies. Okay, if you take the remedy, China, intestinal irritation from the roundworm, which impairment of affective and psychomotor domain. Okay, this is the common symptom. As we know, we have studied into the clinical features. So this is the irritation from the roundworm because of this domain. So if any homeopathic physicians can give the remedy of this remedy to the roundworm, so this is the purely on pathological prescription. So what is now, how to make it to the characteristic symptom? So this is the characteristic of the this remedy. So what is this remedy? The whole face is red and flushed, but around, surrounded the mouth is pale. This is the one guiding symptom. Next guiding symptom, itching of the anus with the mucus like a small pieces of the popcorn, preceded by the pinching colic with aggravation by summer. So this is the guiding symptom. So the patients, you have to get the some of the guiding symptom. This is the personal diagnosis. Okay, spiceria, symptom due to presence of worms in the intestinal or scrofulous diathesis. This is some of the characteristic symptom. Okay, some more characteristic symptom. Child refers to the navel, that is umbilicus, as the most painful part. Stools of large lumps of mucus, itching, tickling and crawling of in anus and rectum with afraid of sharp pointed things. So this is a sharp pointed things. That also it is a characteristic of the Spigelia. Okay. Then some of the unproved remedies. There is a half proved remedies. This is a Pinus sylvester. If you see this clinical feature, if you see this symptom, scrofulous and rachitic children, emaciation of the lower limbs, weak angles in children with discharge of the roundworm. You can see here it is a malnutrition. Symptom of malnutrition you can notice here with the understanding of the parasitology. So still more, if you want to know about much, we have to require scientific experiment with the drug proving is required, may be used as a pathological prescription for the roundworm. And sanitonium, this is a very common remedy which you are using in our homeopathic practice. If you look at this symptom, okay, due to because of migrating larva, this symptom is due to because of migrating larva. Gastrointestinal irritation, itching of the nose, restless sleep and stretching of the muscles, strabismus due to the worms. So this all the symptom must be related to the migrating larva. So if you want to make to confirmation, we require scientific experiment and we can use it for the pathological prescription. The next is abrotenum. So if you see the abrotenum also symptom related to the malnutrition, and again we can use it for the pathological prescription. And the last remedy today discussion is the Sabadilla. So this also symptom due to the larva migrants. You can see the symptoms. If you read the symptom of the Sabadilla in our Metra Medica, you can see mucous membrane of the nose, anus, GIT and nerve, everything will be irritation, itching of the nose, okay, symptom of the gastric symptom and pulmonary symptom, everything will be common. So scientific experiment with the drug proving is required, may be used as the pathological prescription. So that's about the end of this today's class. Okay. So next class we'll go for the ankylostoma duodenale. Thank you.